So just to give you a brief introduction about our organization and our activities, the Global WTERT Council, WTERT stands for Waste to Energy Research and Technology Council. However, it was named back in 2002 because at that time in the States there was an extensive need to develop waste to energy because the States were behind the Europe at that time. However, at the end of 2011, the Global WTERT Council was incorporated under the laws of New York State as an NGO, as a non-governmental organization. Our scope and our aim is to identify the best available techniques for the recovery of energy and materials from various waste materials. As we're saying, waste is gold. We're able to recover all this waste either through recycling and composting or through combustion for the production of energy. And one of our main objectives, and this is where we coincide with the Columbia Global Centers, is to disseminate this information through the web, through the scientific publications, and through some actions to try to bring the various stakeholders in communities together and try to advance in our field, sustainable waste management, in the Columbia Global Centers, the various sustainability perspectives. So some of our achievements was that the waste to energy is the part of the two-volume book of renewable energy sources in Springer. We developed a waste to energy guidebook, which apparently was a 227 pages guidebook, which was supported by the Inter-American Development Bank, and was a guideline on the thermal treatment of waste by taking into account the various forms of thermal treatment, and we included some very interesting case studies. We translated this into Spanish, Portuguese, and now we recently translated this to Chinese. After putting a lot of effort, because apparently waste to energy is associated with public opposition and some organizations are not really keen on including waste to energy as a sustainable waste management technique, after putting a lot of effort, we managed to include WT as a sustainable waste management technique in the latest IPCC report of the UN. Back in 2007, they were only referring to recycling and composting. Now the recent report refers also to waste to energy. We co-authored the UCCRN report, which was a joint effort between the Earth Institute, the Earth Engineering Center, and the UN about sustainable waste management, and this was presented in the COP21 in Paris. As was presented earlier by Dr. Ravina, we are being part of an effort in Singapore to create a legislative framework for the uses of the waste-to-energy residues in civil engineering applications. And we do have our own web information medium, the Big Waste Wise, which was apparently was developed by one of our research associates who come from India also, Mr. Anjita Nepu. So some of our members, we do have at the moment 15 sister organizations around the world, ranging from here in India, which is Dr. Kumar is the head, in Italy, UK, Germany. We've been very, very active through the Columbia Global Centers and the PGIF that we received in Chile, Colombia, Peru, Argentina, and Philippines. And as we very laconically were saying, WTERT and the various sister organizations of the Earth Engineering Center, it's a bridge in between the academia and the industry with the aim to disseminate the information to inform the people about the advancements and the benefits of having some very, very sustainable waste management techniques for the communities. So the problem of sustainability in general, not only the waste management, is associated with the increasing urban population. Apparently, according to the UN, from 2001 to 2015, in India, in Mumbai and New Delhi, it's expected to increase the urban population by 35% and 43%, accordingly. And this imposes a huge threat for the sustainability because we need water, energy, and to manage somehow the waste that will be produced from all these rapidly increasing populations. Apparently, the increasing urban population is typically located in the southern hemisphere, the so-called developing nations, but I don't like actually this word a lot. According to the projections from the World Bank, Perinas Baradatta, another lady who comes from India, it's one of our associates and Columbia alumnus, she did a very well-detailed study about waste management and the waste generation in the world, And even the very optimistic projections imply that waste will not reach a peak by the age of 2100. It will continue the significant increase that started right after the Industrial Revolution. So to give you some numbers, in 2015, it's about 6 million tons of waste, municipal solid waste, that is being produced per day. And this number is expected to be tripled by 2100. We're talking about a huge amount of waste that's expected to come in our world in the near future, to go up to 12 million tons per day. So we have to be able to manage this waste somehow, and we have to be able to design now for the future, for our kids and for the future generations also. So that is why there is a global trend and a global effort to have a transition from the linear, the business as usual model, which implies that processes are being linear, we're having extraction, processing of materials, extensive use, and then the waste is just being disposed of without taking care of it. And we have a mix of technical and biological nutrients, while the new model implies the circular economy model, where the technical and biological nutrients are being separated within the processes. The technical nutrients are being used either as feedstock to other processes, and the biological nutrients are being reintroduced within the atmosphere. Sounds ideal, it has a lot of effort. Talking about waste management, many of you are aware about the four R's. Yes, please. The technical is what is being used for the processes, like some materials and energy that is being used, or some byproducts out of the technical. So for example, if you have a waste-to-energy plant, you have a residue, the bottom and the fly ash. Ideally, the bottom ash, instead of being used, instead of being disposed of in the landfills, you can use it for civil engineering applications, for another industry that has a need for this type of material. So this is the expanded hierarchy of sustainable waste management, which was developed by the Earth Engineering Center, by taking into account the three or four R's, the recycle, reduce, reuse, recover. So the very first tier of sustainability is how to inform people. People are very, very sensitive with the environment, very aware of the different waste streams, and they are really keen on reducing the waste that is being reduced. Then we have recycling, the two forms of composting, which is aerobic and anaerobic, but ideally, and the most efficient systems for recycling and composting imply that we have to have some very extensive and some very advanced source separation schemes in the community. And then for the post-recycled waste, we do have two options. The post-recycled waste is the waste that doesn't have any value in the market, or it doesn't have any recovery potential. We do have two options, the ones that waste to energy and the various forms of landfilling, ranging from modern sanitary landfills with extensive methane recovery and the production of energy thereafter, down to the dominant method apparently, which is unsanitary landfills or open dumping and burning. This is very general about the hierarchy, and if we want to see the picture in the world, the problem is twofold. In the developing world, the dominant method is open dumping and burning. You see all these very sad images. I'm sure actually here in Mumbai, if you go, as we went yesterday, I visited the facility in Nasik. So I was very surprised to see all these open dumps and some little kids try to recover some materials just to gain about $0.50 per year for their income, and followed by informal recycling actions. However, apparently these people are not aware of the public health issues that are associated with these actions, and they are even using acid to leach out the precious metals, or they're burning some PVC coated cables to recover some copper with some very small value in the market, and or manually disassembly of waste electronics equipment. So all these actions are linked with public health issues. While on the other side, we do have the developed nations, typically Western North European countries, plus Japan, Korea, and Singapore, where they are using extensive and state-of-the-art materials recovery facilities, and the post-recycled waste is being combusted in state-of-the-art energy from waste or waste-to-energy facilities. So there is no solution, there is no one solution that fits all, and that's why from the various observations we had from the Earth Engineering Center, we depicted the different levels of sustainable waste management. Because apparently, if we want to reach this optimum circular economy model, this ideal sustainable waste management model, we have to pass through an evolution. We have to realize that things cannot happen overnight. We cannot have today open dams and tomorrow have extensive recycling schemes. People will separate, people will combust the waste for the production of energy. We have to pass through an evolution, and all the successful examples that I will present later on today, like Austria, like Switzerland, they pass through an evolution of about 20 to 30 years, and even more. So the level zero is the dumping and informal sector recycling, which is uncontrolled open dumping and burning, and as we discussed earlier, we have some informal recycling actions. Then as we go up, and apparently the most successful examples in the world have reached about the level four, which is optimum industrial sector recycling combined with waste to energy from the post-combustion recycling. To give you the definition of circular economy, and maybe we can have a discussion after that, how utopic or not is this ideal circular economy model. Level six implies that a fully circular economy model with all waste materials being reused as resources. And we have a system, an associated economy that is regenerative by design. We have to redesign all the processes from the beginning to have minimum waste, minimum energy, and all the byproducts to be used by other systems. Materials flow are of two types. The biological nutrients are designed to re-enter the biosphere, and the technical nutrients are being redesigned to be able to be used for other purposes. So the economy ultimately is powered by renewable energy, and there is no waste that is generated as they are used as materials and energy resources. So products are designed for deconstruction to enable materials and resource construction. So let's address the different waste management techniques, starting from recycling. Recycling, the necessary ingredients for the recycling is to have communities with separate collection schemes. We have citizens who separate recyclables at the source, and markets, very strong secondary markets, that can use and make profit from these recycled materials. Because even if you recover some materials, if you don't have a market to sell these products, then it's meaningless. So in absence of all these above conditions, then the government, or if in Europe they did have these Unite European directives, the government edicts that communities must recycle a certain amount, set up some goals, and set up some guidelines towards these achievements in the recycling schemes. For the composting, the least costly, and it's very easy to apply in some communities, as long as the citizens are willing also to source separate, it's some window composting centers where people are just throwing the food waste in open windows, and then this material is being used in agriculture. And then we have the next and the most costly technique, which is the anaerobic digestion facility, able to recover with the aid of some microbes the methane and thereafter the recovery of energy. However, it's very, very important for the composting schemes to have source separation. These graphs gives us on the x-axis, we have the different heavy metals, and on the y-axis, we have the concentration in MSW. So the blue bar is the mixed waste, the red bar is the partially separated waste, and the green bar is the source separated waste. So in order to have a very, very good compost that can be used for agriculture as a fertilizer, we need, it's necessary to have an extensive source separated scheme to avoid all this contamination from the heavy metals into and onto the land. But there are some limitations to recycling and composting, and this is very obvious. I mean, if you look in your bin, I'm sure you cannot recover 100% of these materials, because some people are claiming and are dreaming of having 100% recycling schemes. You cannot recycle 100% of your waste, because you have materials that cannot be recovered, and you don't have materials that do not have a value in the market. And even the most successful systems, like Austria, recovers about 50% of their municipal solid waste. So for example, after many efforts to increase recycling, California, which is one of the most advanced actually state in the US, now we'll see with the new administration, about less than 10% of the plastic waste were being recycled. So there was a huge room for plastic. Therefore, it has been necessary universally to develop some techniques for the utilization of the post-recycled waste. And as we said, there are only two techniques. The estimated global disposition of the urban post-recycling waste was about 1.3 billion tons per year. So out of this, about 230 million tons were combusted for the production of energy. About 250 million tons were landfilled with partial methane recovery, and more than 800 million tons were landfilled without methane recovery, and this means were mainly open dumps. And MSW generation has tripled since 1950, and it's expected to be six times more by 2030. And let's evaluate the two different techniques, the sanitary landfilling versus the waste to energy, the gladiators. So sanitary landfilling protects the grounds and the surface waters as long as sanitary landfill cuts down greenhouse gas emissions by about 0.5 tons of CO2 equivalents per ton of waste as compared to the open dumps. The cost is in between $100 to $200 per annual ton of capacity. However, uses one square meter of land for every 10 tons of MSW that's landfilled. When we're saying about sanitary landfills, we're talking about this type of landfills, which is very safe for the community. However, it takes out a lot of land. To give you an idea, we did a study in China for the case of Beijing, and literally these yellow pins are the landfills that were surrounding Beijing in 2011. So all this was landfills that were surrounding the capital of China, imposing a huge threat if we look at the future. So the global use of land for landfilling in 1 year. As we said, one square meter is gone forever for every 10 tons of MSW that is landfilled. The current global landfilling converts an estimated 100 square kilometers of green fields of forests to landfills. If it were done at one landfill, it would use up a land surface equal to that of metropolitan Paris, which is a huge area. And at present rate of MSW generation, continued landfilling would use up to 10,000 square kilometers in this century. And let's have a comparison, colonizing Mars versus doing away with landfilling. Many, many nations are claiming and are investing a lot of money and efforts to try to billions of dollars in missions in the hope of developing living space in Mars. How much would it cost to create 100 square kilometers of Earth-like land on Mars? Huge. And the other option is to combust the waste from the production of energy and materials, because from the combustion we have electricity and district heating and cooling, so waste to energy, and from the residues, the bottom and the fly ash, is extensively being used for civil engineering applications, so we do have resources from waste also. A brief introduction to a waste-to-energy facility. Usually the waste is being stored in a bunker, and then with the aid of a crane, it's being thrown into a moving grate for combustion, and from the steam, we can produce through a steam generator electricity. From the low-pressure steam, it can be used for district heating, cooling, or for industrial purposes. And all these plants operate with state-of-the-art air pollution control systems, and all the reported emissions we do have from all these facilities worldwide, about 1,500 facilities worldwide, operate with minimal emissions as compared to the nationally established limits, which apparently are very stringent limits. It's more stringent than the coal-fired plants. And this is extensively being used in the Western and Northern European countries, where the bottom ash, which is about 20% as compared to the initial MSW feedstock, is being with the aid of magnets and eddy current separators, they're removing the ferrous and non-ferrous metals, and there is the mineral fraction is being used extensively for bituminous application, for road construction, for noise and wind barriers, for the construction of embankments. So according to Professor Brunner, who is one of the leading academics in this field, the objectives of waste management, of sustainable waste management, are the destruction of pathogens, the volume reduction, environmental protection, mineralization and immobilization of hazardous substances, land, material, and non-renewable energy conservation, public acceptance, and affordable capital cost. WT, waste to energy, meets all these criteria, but has some issues with the last two. So for the public acceptance of waste to energy, we need to inform the people. We need to inform the public, because apparently there is a confusion between two very, very different, much different terms: incineration versus waste to energy. We're talking about mass burn combustion in state-of-the-art plants, while incinerators range from small scale to large, even from household to large scale incinerators without any air pollution control systems in many, many cases. And because of some accidents from these incinerators, this put a stigma in the waste to energy industry also. So for example, any new proposal of waste to energy opposed by people who claim that a new WT will emit dioxins and furans and will destroy the community. From Columbia University, we've done a lot of inventory studies for dioxins. And for example, in the US, the average dioxin emissions was 0.027 out of the 77 waste to energy plants. The limit is 0.1 nanograms toxic equivalent. In France, 0.013. In South Korea, all the plants, 0.007. So all the reported data we have and all the studies we're doing from Columbia University have proved the benefits and the sustainability of these techniques. Because apparently, most of these plants are marbles for the community. With regard to the carbon dioxide emissions, and with the comparison between with the various forms of landfilling, waste to energy saves about 1 ton of CO2 equivalent per ton of MSW. If we compare waste to energy with other energy sources, it's comparable to natural gas. And to put it simply for the people, because in some cases dioxins or furans or the destruction of dioxins is associated with maybe some engineering background, we did a research study from Columbia, and on the x-axis, we do have the total plant capacity, the waste to energy capacity, versus the distance of waste to energy from the city center that they serve. And on the average, the 1,500 plants in the world are located in an average distance of about 5 kilometers from the city center. So apparently within the city center. And all these plants operate for the last century. And we haven't observed any single operational problem, and we haven't observed any single public health issue associated with all these facilities, with mass burn combustion, not incineration. So to wrap up, we do have two techniques, WT and landfilling. The WT advantages over the landfilling is that the destruction of pathogens, the conservation of land near cities, about 1 square meter per every 10 tons of waste, electricity production, about 0.5 megawatt hours per ton of electricity, the greenhouse gas reduction, 0.5 to 1 ton of CO2 equivalent per ton of waste, and metal and resources recovery. However, it has some issues with the capital investment. However, we will explain later on some recent advancements from a neighboring country of India that managed to reduce significantly the capital investment for waste to energy. So let's see the global picture. As we said, ideally communities have to recycle, compost, and thereafter combust their waste for the production of energy. That means that the most sustainable nations are the nations who have moved away from landfills. So we did a global analysis from Columbia University. We took all the national data and we created the ladder of sustainable waste management of nations that with countries that have moved away from landfills. Because in some communities, it's being said that waste to energy opposes the development of recycling or composting. However, this is not true. All the most developed nations, in terms of sustainable waste management, have proved that recycling, composting, and waste to energy go hand in hand. The top countries in the ladder are Western and Northern European countries, plus Japan and Singapore. Because one of the metrics of sustainability is how to decouple the different indicators from the growth of the country, usually defined from the GDP, the gross domestic product of the country, we created a matrix where on the x-axis we have the GDP per capita of the various nations as a percentage, because everything is relative, as compared to the European 28 average, Europe, because Europe is the most advanced country, continent in the field of waste management. And on the y-axis, we compared this simple indicator, so which countries have moved away from landfills, with respect to the EU 28. So we have four quadrants. In the first one are countries with high GDP and high sustainable waste management index. And the second quadrant is the only country who has managed to decouple the growth from the sustainability of waste management, and it's Korea. Another very interesting finding of this graph is that all the next generation of economies, the BRICS, belong to the third quadrant. That means low GDP per capita, but very, very low sustainable waste management index. US, it's it's very low in terms of sustainable waste management, and now I guess it will become lower and lower with all these things, yeah. So, how South Korea has done it? South Korea invested a lot of time and effort to educate people, and it took them about 10 years through planning, policy, regulation, public education at national level, and implementation at municipal level, a centralized model targeting towards a more decentralized communities. They had a huge assistance by national and regional agencies, various NGOs, and they had a very strong citizen compliance and participation. A very successful case for the increase of recycling and composting was the UK. So in the UK, they implemented a landfill tax. So the landfill gate fee consists of two parameters. The one is what is being given by the operators, and the other is the tax introduced by the government. So the UK government introduced this very high landfill gate fee, and they increased the landfill gate fee from a low of about $10 per annual per ton of waste that's being disposed up to $110 per ton. So that means that the municipality were not really keen on paying this huge amount of money to landfill their waste, and that's why they moved away from landfills. It was an indirect incentive for recycling, composting, and for waste to energy thereafter. Because apparently, to show you the connection between this increase in the landfill tax and the recycling is the blue line here, the total recycling, and increased from a low of about 10% in 2001 up to about 49% in 10 years' time. But again, it needed much time. And through the implementation of very, very strong policies, because it was the European directive that was introduced and implemented into their national law. And they invested a lot of effort and time through a huge campaign to try to inform people through smart advertisement. And this apparently altered the social behavior, altered the subconscious, and people became more conscious towards the recycling, because they were seeing a repetitive message every single day. And at some point, they were very, very careful about the source separation of their waste. So they had, for example, I recycle for my education, or I recycle for my team. One of my favorites, Dr. Ravina, is when I stop spinning, I'm coming back as an helicopter, like a small fan, showing like the concept of upcycling the materials. All your recycled plastic bottles can become as back as food shards. So this will spread all over the different cities of the UK, and this apparently changed the social behavior. So a successful case in the conversion of open dams to waste to energy, because we saw two examples, which are more developed communities. Let's see the example of China, because you saw earlier that Beijing was literally surrounded by open dams. And they had a huge transition towards waste to energy in about 10 to 15 years. So in 2001, they had about 36 waste to energy facilities, and in 2014, they had 188 facilities. To give you a comparative number, in the States, the very first facility opened in the 80s, and now we're having about exactly 77 facilities that operate in the States. So how they did this great achievement, their great advancement, China. First one, China, they invest a lot in the industrial and academic research and development and the mass production instead of one plant at the time. So, and they gave some very strong incentives through the electricity. So the government introduced a very strong incentive and which was saying that if you produce energy from waste, you will receive a credit of $30 per megawatt hour of electricity in addition to what you are receiving from the electricity in the grid. And they introduce and they include waste to energy in their renewable energy source law. And this, they managed to produce plants and construct plants at a much lower cost as compared to the European and the American plants. So the average of about 25 plants in the EU and the States was about $880 per annual ton. While on an average, about the Chinese plants, it's about $228 per annual ton. I visited a facility in Nanjing in China last summer, and it was 1 million tons of capacity, the facility, and the cost was $190 per annual ton, which is very, very cheap. And all these technologies and all these facilities operate with all these state-of-the-art air pollution control systems, and all the reported emissions are well below the very stringent established limits. We did an inventory. Now, yesterday, actually, I received the first draft. I will have some more numbers in the near future about this, about the dioxin emissions from these Chinese developments. And all the plants that we examined from China Everbright were well below the EU and the US standards, not only the Chinese standards, but the EU and the US standards. And that means that all these facilities are very sustainable for the community. And why all this talk about the China becoming a leader in waste to energy? Because China should be a very good example for other Asian countries also. And developed nations took several decades, as you saw earlier, to reach their present state of development and achievement in sustainable waste management. While developed nations can leapfrog and become leaders in advanced technology. India, in particular, is in a very good position to cultivate and advance some collaboration with China, and thereafter take this very strong and very good example for the case of India, and phase out landfilling. And how to advance sustainable waste management in India? Because we've been listening to many different ideas. For example, it is necessary to educate people that the source separation and utilization of specific waste materials that can be thereafter being processed for the production of other products like oil from pyrocrat, which is a very, very impressive technique. I visited this facility yesterday. It is necessary to have a centralized policy that targets to decentralized model like the European approach. It is necessary to include the informal recyclers to the formal recycling system and alleviate these public health issues. It is necessary to assess the local characteristics case by case because one solution doesn't fit all. However, is there much time for India? Because this is what is the situation in India. Here in Mumbai, for example, it's open dumping and burning. And all these are associated with significant public health issues for the communities. So this is the dominant method. About 22,000 tons of carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, particulate matters, NOx and CO2 are being produced by these open dumps here in Mumbai, according to a study that was done by one of our research associates, by Ranjita Nepu. Open burning is the second largest contributor of hydrocarbons and particulate matters in Mumbai. And this is followed by informal recycling actions. These are some images from the very interesting thesis, which apparently depicts the situation here in India. It's a 300-page document with the information for India. And these informal recycling actions are associated with significant public health issues. So this will have the probability of occurring an accident, and they have the various forms of diseases, from elevated mucus production to high PM10 exposure to altered immunity, etc., etc. So, for example, the particulate matter was the main concern also from these actions. If you see, the red bar is the waste pickers, these informal recyclers. And the green bar is the MSW staff that works with protective equipment. and the blue is the controlled population. So as you can see, the waste pickers are being exposed every day, every hour, every minute in these very significant public health issues. And there is huge potential for energy generation from energy from MSW and fossil fuel coal displacement. According to the study that was done by Ranjita Nepu, the big megacities here in India are producing about 45,000 tons of MSW per day, able to produce about 745 megawatts of power, and this is associated with the replacement of about 8.3 million tons of coal per year. On Thursday, I visited a facility in Jabalpur, which apparently is a successful transformation of a 30 acres open dump, this was a situation before, to a 10 acres waste storage plant, able to produce electricity. This is the facility, and now it's an ongoing effort. And I managed to create some new land, which apparently the next step is to create some recreational activities for the locals, maybe having some fountains or a park nearby the plant, because all these plants operate without any problems. And yesterday I visited one very, very interesting example. Luckily, one of the owners of the facility is here also today. The pyrocrat was a transformation of plastic waste into oil. And this is something that we have to consider and we have to take into account for the sustainability, because plastic is a very challenging material also. And to show you some images of some waste energy facilities worldwide, this in Taiwan, with have an observation deck on top. This is the newly built plant in Copenhagen, in Denmark, which has a ski slope on top. Talking about the recreational activities. This is one of the Spittelau facility in Vienna, which is considered to be one of the top 10 sightseeing in Vienna, because it has this Gaudi architectural design. Gaudi was one of the most famous architects in the 20th century from Barcelona. And now is this to be built the new plant in Shenzhen in China with a capacity of 1.6 million tons per year. It's going to be the biggest in the world. And you can see that it's like a marvel for the community. It has a very aesthetically pleasant design. In Leeds, in the UK, a green building, glass and green all over the place. I mean, who didn't want like a marble in the neighborhood? And Brescia in Italy, which operates since the 1995 with a capacity of 700,000 tons per year. So for those of you interested in sustainable waste management, either Google WTERT or look up Google the WT guidebook that we developed. And as we say earlier, we see waste as an opportunity, waste as gold. So according to an Austrian myth, this is the fountain of youth, where some senior people are going inside and are becoming young again. And this is how we see waste, as a new resource and as a new energy material. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, thank you very much.